technical consultant from MIDAS IT headquarters in South Korea. Thank you for attending today's webinar. Today's webinar, the MIDAS geotechnical one, is the modeling in TBM tunneling with the design approaches by Koshimo Yasuhiro from AECOM. So Dr. Koshimo has experience of a wide range of projects as a specialist geotechnical tunneling and structural engineer covering major infrastructure across a range of sectors in the UK and overseas in Europe, Africa, Middle East, North and South America. His duties covered site investigation supervision, earthwork, slopes, foundations, earthquake design, tunneling, special foundations, and structural design of underground metro stations. So now let me over the mic to Koshimo. So Koshimo, could you please start?
Share with you the webinar of today. I will try to see also my, I don't know if you can see my camera. Okay.
Okay, so
today we will speak about the tunneling modeling in MIDAS GTS, and in particular referring to the tunnel boring machine. The index of the webinar is the following. We have a brief introduction to the TBMs. The TBM, the design, the permanent load, and the construction loads that we can simulate with easily simulate in the MIDAS, the standards and the rules in the TBM design. Then we focused on the analytical design, which is a part, a fundamental part of the modeling, although it's not entering in directly in the process. Then we focused on the TBM modeling, the phase pressure, the installation of the annular gap and of the end of the ring, the segments joints modeling, the modeling of a single with versus the twin bored tunnel. Which is a TBM? Everyone knows what is a TBM. A TBM is a machine capable of excavating a tunnel with a complete cross section. What we can efficiently reproduce in MIDAS is the cutter head, and where we wanted to do it is the pass, the push jacks that are going to transfer the loads of the head onto the rings. Also, it is important when we are going to model a TBM, also to understand which type of TBM we are going to model. If it is a model of, if it is a hard rock, rock, soil, and in order to forecast, if we want, also the method of transfer the loads onto the ground. For example, in this case, I will in this case, for example, for hard rock, we have the grippers. So the grippers are pushing in the lateral of the tunnel of the on the rock. In this case, we have the APB, the double shield and the single shield. So we are going to push the jacks onto the ring. And for APB, we are going to also check the face pressure. I have some questions already. Sorry.
Koshimo, yeah, you can answer the questions after end of webinar.
I collected I collect a very old but still valid catalog from Mitsubishi, regarding the different type of TBM, depending on the slurry or if they are closed, if they are working in closed or in fully open way. It is important to understand how the TBM work, because it is important to understand what we are going to model. In particular, we have if we are going to model the phase pressure, which is also the something I will show you in this webinar, it is important to understand if our TBM is working as an APB. So the phase pressure is with the screw is in is very at the bottom of the head face. So we have we can have a triangular or trapezoidal or uniformal pressure, or it is a slurry. So the screw is at is at more or less two-third eight of the TBM. So we will have the pressure. We will start in more or less. More or less, we will start at this from here, from the one-third of the APB till the till the end of the structure. Okay. Before going down to the presentation, it's better to start with the nomenclature, in particular with the what is a a segment, which is a ring, which is a joint, and whatever. The ring is understood as a number or a series of a number of segments. One segment or dowel is called the segment are connected with the dowel, and we have two joints. The so-called lateral joints, which are the joints between the segments in the same ring, and the joints between the circumferential joints, which are the joints between segments but in different rings. Also, it is important on the right side of this slide to define the so-called secondary elements of the joints, and they are these are the segment. This is the joint. As you can see, the joint is not fully in the area of the segment, but we have a reduction in this area, so this reduction can be efficiently simulated in a numerical analysis. Then we have a gasket. Normally here in this photo we have one gasket, but in some projects there is also required to have a double gasket, one in outer and the second inner of the tunnel. The main function of the gasket is to guarantee the water tightness of the tunnel. And then we have the mortar, which is the mortar or pig gravel, depending if we are excavating in soil or a rock, or if we are, it is the material to fill the annular gap between the head and the ring. Okay, regarding the TBM design for permanent loads, the so-called permanent loads are the loads that we are going to act permanently on the on our structure, and the ground loads, the water loads, earthquake, and whatever. In this case, the procedure is to start with the design. Design can be done by empirical or by hand calculation, then going by to the analytical design, and finally to the numerical model. Regarding the construction load, are these are those loads that derived from the ring installation, and they can't. And actually, in my experience, sometimes I simulate there in my desk, but it's not very. It's very time consuming to simulate the difference of the jack, the segment directions, and whatever. In engineering practice, we usually follow in Ecom, but also in other companies, the the formulas, you can see that they are very simple formulas based on on a simple structural configuration. The only thing maybe we can simulate with a numerical model because it sounds attractive is the pushing system. The pushing system can be also solved analytically with a strat and tie approach, but also can be efficiently reproduced by MADES, in particular in those cases where we want to study particularly phenomenons of, for example, of displacements or whenever doing the construction. Regarding the standards and the rules in TBM design, in general, in MIDAS GTS, is not collected any standards. It's not like in MIDAS Civil where we have some standards, the ORCO, the ASHTO, the ACI, I think also the Chinese regulation. In MIDAS GTS, there is no this tool, maybe in future will be, but it's so the all the analysis we are going to undertake must be considered like serviceability analysis. And if we want to carry out some accidental or ultimate analysis, we have to apply the coefficient derived by the standards we have to use. Regarding the construction loads, there is no general rule regarding the standards loads. Each country more or less try to give some hints or some rules of thumbs regarding the construction loads. I would say the most effective and the most developed is the Japanese standards that give not only the regulation for construction loads, I mean, which are meant to be construction loads, which are the permanent loads, so the definition, but also the structural elements and the limit of applicability depending on the of the type of rim, if it's tapered, universal, trapezoidal, and whatever. My opinion is, in order to take into account the construction loads, and because of the most of cases, the construction loads are the loads where, at the end of the day, they are dimensioning the steel quantity within the segment. I would suggest to design with an overall safety factor of 1.05, 1.10 to have a reserve of 5-10% of extra safety factor. This is my personal opinion. Regarding the analytical designer, I would like to underline that a numerical model and numerical modeling is the final path of a dichotomic process that it takes into account the hand of manual calculation, empirical calculation, the analytical design, and finally the numerical model. Here in this sketch by Iftmier of 1996, I highlighted here two important methods. On the left, we have the so-called hyperstatic method, which is the method defined by Chesney in his book, The Art of Tunneling, in 1970s, then improved by Schulz and Dudek. Then we have the so-called equivalent of the beam method, that are very old method, and also depending on the soil condition, can be over-conservative or very optimistic. So I would not suggest. Then we have the method based on the Timoshenko formulas. We have the so-called ground convergence confinement curves, Buda, Bardi, Rybaki, and whatever. And then finally, we have on the right side, we have the numerical solution based on the equations of Zinkevich. Regarding analytical design for TBM, I would suggest to implement the criteria highlighted by in Japanese standards of shield tunneling. which is collected in this slide, and also I would say collected also by the IDA, which is basically the static model improved, considering that the ring is not radially loaded, but is vertical and horizontal loaded with the differences derived by the in situ stress coefficient. This method is quite attractive for us, for the tunnel engineers, because as you can see here, we have the closed formulations of bending moment and axial force, and this can be easily implemented, for example, in an Excel file. So it is easier for us to understand, depending on the meter, depending on the soil conditions, the water table, and whatever, to check where are the differences in terms of internal forces to have a rough number before going to numerical model. The other analytical design I would like to highlight is the ground convergence confinement curve. Everyone in this webinar knows perfectly which is the criteria, which is the formulation, which are the hypotheses and the output of the ground convergence confinement curve. The only thing I would like to highlight here is the evaluation of the front face, very important for a TBM, because it is important to estimate the face pressure, and if we have to work with the TBM, I mean without any face pressure, or with a slurry, or with a PBX, so with some face pressure, and this can be also done or estimated with, for example, the extrusion of the front with Panex formulations of 1989 or 1990, and it is also too important to have a rough number of it. Okay, after a really quick introduction, let's go directly to the TBM, to the modeling. First of all, I would like to highlight something, that modeling is not always required. There are some cases where, as designer, we are requested to our clients to carry out a model, but in some cases, it's not required, because the modeling solution will not apport or would not bring much more information than the analytical ones. However, so my first hint is, don't start with a modeling. Let's start with a hand calculation, analytical, and then finally go to the BM modeling. There are some cases, however, where modeling is required, because the analytical can't have the accuracy of the numerical solution. For example, the possible risk of TBM entrapment, and this is the basic to, for example, study the TBM feasibility, the estimation of the face pressure, the lack of uniformity of the tunnel front, lower cover on top of tunnel, where, for example, the ground convergence confinement, the GCC, the ground convergence confinement curve, did not give us a good estimation of the displacement, presence of the buildings, or in general, a specific study, like, for example, thermal study, CFD studies, and whatever. The first case and the easiest way is to model the TBM as 2D analysis and using the LFD, I mean, the deformation of the equivalent deformation based on the ground convergence confinement curve. The so-called LDF in MIDAS is the equivalent to the beta factor in Plaxis, which is the relaxation coefficient. Okay, this is very easy to carry out a 2D analysis of a TBM in MIDAS. I will show you if it's possible to open. Yeah. Okay. This is a very simple element where we have the geostatic, I mean, the restoration of the initial soil conditions. That we have, then we have the these are the three cases. Then we have the TBM excavating, where we excavated the TBM, and then we have the TBM lining. As you can see, the time of calculations for this for this model is practically very very quick. It's already done, so we can go here. And for example, in the latest phase, we can check the displacement, or we can check, for example, the plastic status, and whenever. Okay, so it's very easy and very quick. Then the particular case of modeling, and in this case the is not so easy. In this case, for example, this is a shaft in London for PTT, where Ecom is a designer, and we have asked to carry out, I don't know what to take it out, to carry out here a wall engineering of this micro tunnel we had more or less at the middle of the shaft to optimize the execution of this micro tunnel. So what we did was to model all the shaft, but not modeling the tunnel, because the tunnel did not enter in our design, in this design, so it was not important. And then modeling the trying to have a complete symmetry of the shaft, and then modeling the micro tunnel. As you can see here, we model the micro tunnel with our shell, so without our lining, while in the shaft we didn't model, because in the shaft we don't have it. And also what we had to check, and what is important for you to check, is the compatibility of the geometry. The compatibility of geometry here in this case, as you can see here in these points, is very important to avoid the so-called error number 4004, which is a warning actually, and it is an error relating to the mesh. So, for example, if I will open this, this will take a bit more time, but it is worth. Okay. As you can see here, you have all the shells. All the shells of the micro tunnel. Here we have, okay, this is the first part of the tunnel and with the shaft, then we have the second one, but it's not important the mesh, is important the geometry. Okay. As you can see here, we have a first area, which is the tunnel, the micro tunnel, and here we have this is the area of the concrete collar you have to design for the tunnel, for the between the tunnel and the shaft. How we did it? We did it with a very powerful a tool we have in Magath, which are this one. These are the Boolean operations, where you have different surfaces and different volumes, and then you can fuse, cut, common, and bidet, and whenever. So these elements together with this, together with these elements, translate, rotate, mirror, sweep, translate, and whenever, allows us to do almost everything in very quickest way. Another case is a TBM shaft entrance. This is for a Silvertown project. These are the faces of execution. So we had the piles. Here we have the jet routing treatment too, because in this area, the TBM is the APB actually was not using the phase pressure. So we have to guarantee a very good material and also a dry material not to have the water table. So the phase is that the tunnel come from this, then is rotating and then is going through. So in this case, what we did was to model all the phases. And as you can see here, something we model four different areas of jet grouting. Why? Because we didn't know actually if I mean the hand calculation, analytical calculation gave us that with one shot of jet grouting was enough to guarantee the water tightness and the ground of and the ground characteristic of the APB, but we wanted to check if it was true or not. So we could check it, and in Miners was very easy to create this, because with the command duplicate and the command extrude, you can create these elements. Once you find one element, you can extrude, you can duplicate, and it's very easy. Here we have the vertical displacement, and here we have the horizontal displacement. A particular of this element is of this model is that the connection between the APB and the wall, the APB here was modeled by solid element, because we were not interested in because it was out of our scope. It was not interested in the APB internal forces, so bending moment, axial and shear, but we were interested only about the connection and the hydraulics conditions behind the our wall. So we did it just to make also the connection easier, and because in Midas, if you have a shell with a solid, the connection between the elements is automatic. But if you have two shells, you have to extract geometry and do it and select it and doing it with pin or whatever. So it's easier to do with solid elements. Another particular case is the cross passages. The cross passages, you can design different cross passages. You have the steel collars. This is, for example, the case of Pajares in Spain. You have the increment of lining section, as I showed you before, when you have the shaft in TTT. This lining was done, but in only in rift walls. And also in another case, you have the horizontal rise boring. And this also for hard rock and whatever. So in this case, we have the modeling of cross passages. As you can see here, this mesh is very fine, because here we simulate the phase pressure, and we simulate the connection between joints and also the pushing system. So we had to do a very fine model, and I will explain later on why this fine mesh is required. These are the cross passages, these are the vertical elements, these are the vertical displacement and the horizontal displacement. As you can see, the symmetrical results are important. It is important to underline that if the model is symmetrical, the results must be symmetrical. This can be result in a very silly sentence, but sometimes it is not so silly. So also you have to check the symmetry of your model. Then regarding cross passage, here there is the analytical distribution of the internal of the stresses around a lateral opening of a tunnel. You have the increment in this area and the decrement of this I will show you. You have the increment in this area at drift walls, and you have the decrement before because of the arcing effect on an arcing structure in sidewalls of the crown. In Midas, we have exactly the same, as you can see here, in this part of, sorry, I will move myself, in this part of, okay. In this part here, you have exactly the same in Midas. So it seems that the model is working and gives something. Comparing to the analytical model. Also, in this case, if we plot the vertical and horizontal stresses, we have the same effect, which does mean that the ground and the shell, they have the same level of stresses, so we are not losing any stress. And this not losing of stress means that we are working on the elastic conditions. If there is some differences between the stresses within the ground and the shells, means that this part of stress is converting in yielding of the soil, and so we have to avoid this yielding of the soil with a micro piles umbrella, with jet grouting, with treatment, or with increasing the section of the cross passage. Another interesting issue to evaluate the TBM modeling is the geotechnical the value of the back analysis. This is an example of back analysis we have required to carry out. We had between two mountains, and the TBM must pass the one mountain to the other, and the execution of the designer was to carry out a so-called hard embankment, which is embankment of selected material with fibers, with BTR fibers to connect between within the embankment. So the result was that the embankment failed. And as you can see, the TBM is still running, so we couldn't take out the TBM. And here you have the man putting the machine. Here you can see the BTR that are completely broken. And this, we came out the back analysis. And in terms of longitudinal displacement along the E axis, we checked that the displacement were around 3 millimeters, so we are not very worried about the displacement. And also the displacement, vertical displacement, we are about 16 millimeters, so something that it is not very worried. What instead was very worried was the plastic elements. It seems that the embankment, when we simulate the construction of TBM, the embankment failed, and failed like a solid, a rigid solid, so it was not settled, it was like a rigid solid, because of the so-called silo effect. And this is this was due to the fact that the embankment, the projected embankment, was not so wider comparing to the shape of the TBM. Face pressure. To simulate the face pressure in Midas, this is, for example, an example of trapezoidal pressure that we have to simulate. We have two elements. We have two. We can do in two ways. Or with the command extract a surface. For example, if I go here. If I go here, I came to mesh, for example, I came here, extract face, and I will extract this face. Okay, I will register this phase in oval shape. So I will register phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four, five, and whenever. And when I will register this phase, I can come here. I can define a set, for example, phase pressure. And here in phase pressure, I can select, for example, a phase. I can select here, and I can select. I can select here a phase, and I can give them the pressure I want to give in X direction, in Y direction, or in Z direction. I can choose the direction I want and whatever. This is one case. Okay. The second case is simply set up a restraint in tunnel advance. So if I will come to the same model here, I can define a constraint. So I can, for example, deactivate the geometry, and I can activate, for example, the mesh of here. I can come here, define a constraint here, and say, okay, you are pinned, fixed, or no rotation. Okay, the both of cases A or B are valid. Okay, the option A is valid when the face pressure is plays a fundamental role into the design. For example, if you are designing the classical tunnel and you have the building, so you want to check if your settlement profile is comparable with the analytical calculation, for example, for Bosch Carlin according, or if you are working with hydraulic conditions, so you are doing a couple of analysis of lowering the hydraulic conditions beyond the face of the TBM or the APB. The option B is when you already know that your face pressure is not important in the whole process of the TBM design. So the influence of face pressure can be neglected, but you don't want to have the displacement in longitudinal direction of the tunnel, so you have simulated just the restraint. At the end of the day, it's up to the designer to decide which one of the two ways are more important. Regarding the installation of the ring and the annular gap, it's more or less the same. I mean, for TBM, you have four phases: the phase zero, when you build the ring within the shield; then the phase one, when you create the saddle; and then you have the phase two and phase three, when you're less balanced, you are simulating that you are building your annular gap. Also, this can be simulated in Midas. You have two options. One option is to create an external solid element. And this can be done all creating a solid, you can call gap, or simply changing the property in mesh set, or simulating the deformation of the ground in this gap as contraction line. Both elements, both point A and B, can be used. For second time, it's up to the designer which one is best. In my experience, I always, for 95% of cases, I am using the option B, because it is quicker, the computation time is, so the model is quicker. And second, because the contraction line always is something based on empirical data. And if I use the option A, in some cases I reach that the contraction line is not what I have established, what my client or what other people establish as the criteria. So then I enter in a big discussion with someone, and I would like to avoid the discussion. The second is the modeling the connection between lining. This is quite something we are doing and very. Very quick in general, we could say that most of the designing we represent the analytical the ring as monolithical structure with the same thickness. In some cases, there are some designer that who reduced the inertia based on the formulation of Wood in 1970s, depending on the number of joints and the number of segments. But in numerical modeling in MIDAS, you can simulate efficiently also the connection between different tunnel segments. And this is what, for example, we usually do with creating an interface between the segments with nonlinear according to the Janssen law. This is quite interesting if you wanted to, for example, if you have to carry out an earthquake checking of the of your ring in some area, so you have to simulate also the connections between joints. Here there are some elements. As you can see, you have different elements, and then you you are with a quadrangular, and then less by less you are doing with an hybrid mesh, and here you have the connections. For example, here you have a vertical opening for a ventilation shaft. And also the connection between lining segments. In some cases, also you want to simulate, for example, the joints is happening. For, if you recall, in the model of the cross passage where the mesh was really very, very fine. In this case, you can evaluate also the ovalization of the tunnel. This is the one of the most important formulation, but you have thousands of formulation of ovalization regarding the different model. And this is the reason why you have to simulate a very fine mesh, because if you want to carry out the equivalent beam criteria, which is the criteria established by Berriut, but also by Bloom in his PhD thesis, you have to simulate this element between segments, and to simulate these elements you need to do a very fine mesh. Another way to do simulating of this is to go directly to MIDAS Civil, and doing in MIDAS Civil simulating creating a doc cross section. Then with this cross section, you can work on MIDAS Civil. In this case, you can work with the moment curvature diagram. This is an example we did in MIDAS, and we create the different subtle extensions, because we wanted to study it and to study, depending of the extension of the saddle, the differences in terms of plastic inch within the tunnel. Finally, we came up with the worst scenario, which was the asymmetrical saddle. And then another thing that we also can simulate, the we can use the TBM modeling, is the simulating the when we have a twin bored tunnels. In this case, we can carry out the, for example, this is the analytical calculation of Chesney, the art of tunneling, but there are other calculations, for example, those of Habib based on the index area. There are some references also in the FHWA in US. I mean, you have a you have a different cases where you can study the influence on the pillar rock and the increment of the tension and the tension on the side wall and the compression between the pillar rock to understand if your tunnels are need some ground treatment or some treatment between in the pillar rock between the two tunnels. In general, I mean, there are some cases where our clients also study, instead of two tunnels very close between them, they want to study a bigger tunnel. And there are some cases where we supported our decision or our decisional matrix based also on numerical modeling. So carrying out, for example, settlement analysis, carrying out constructibility analysis, the experience of TBM. In general, there is no general rule. It depends on Other boundary conditions, for example, the alignment, if we can slightly move the alignment to create a space between the two single bore tunnels, or we can't, so it's better to go with a bigger tunnel. And this is, for example, this is another example of London, of the Silvertown project. This is the launch chamber, it is a pinot. So the TBM will start from this chamber. This is the TBM, then we'll go to the rotation, we'll rotate, and we'll come in this tunnel. So we wanted to study the influence of the second tunnel, the first tunnel, as you can see here, they are very close, and the influence of the existing tunnel on the shaft. So this is the faces, and these are the results, where we have the initial stage, we have the bottom of excavation where we carry out a flow analysis. As you can see here, the flow analysis also will affect the tunnel, so in this case also will affect, and this is the reason why we simulate also the tunnel, because will affect also the face pressure. And these are the vertical displacement when we excavate the bottom excavation, and then we have the execution of the tunnel. We are in 28 millimeters. Then I will finish with my conclusions regarding the finite element modeling. It's important, very important. More than geotechnical parameters, it's important to understand which is the best soil model we have to adopt in our analysis. In some cases, it's a valid the Mort Coulomb, in other cases, it's the hardened soil, in other cases, it's the soft soil that is a developing of the calm clay, in other cases, you have to use the ochre brown and whatever. So, there is no general rule. My suggestion is to carry out parametric analysis to check which soil constitutive law is capable of capturing the real behavior or the most likely behavior of the tunnel. Regarding the dewatering, it's important not only for Midas but in general for other software to implement what is really required and always to carry out a hand calculation. Evaluate the interface between soil and structure is needed, and it is very important to understand the interface when it's required and when it is not required, the interface model. Finally, regarding my experience with the GTS, my personal experience with GTS and also using other comparable softwares in the market is that for me it's very easy to create geometries, because part of the Boolean operations on soil and surface that we already saw. It is also interesting the import comments we have in Midas. They are very more user friendly than other software. Does not require any softwares or any subscription, like VIP subscription, for example. But everything is under the umbrella of Midas, and also the. Defining the polyline, the 3D polyline with different layers, Midas is capable of reading polyline, reading surface, and even volumes. Although the software is pretty geotechnical, there are, as you can see, the Johnson law, so there are some good structural approaches to try. To do a shortcut simulation of the structural components within the different soil structural elements. And then the most attractive is the combining the civil GTS with the civil. This is very, very attractive because you can create a mesh with a tunnel in GTS in NX, and then export this into civil and do a coupled analysis, a real soil structural analysis, and re-export the results in your GTS. This is very, very attractive. And with this, I finish my presentation. I will answer the questions. There are thousands of them. Okay. Okay. Could not see. Can we have a side pressure deflection loads? Yes, you can see. How the support for the tunnel are fixed with excavation? You can excavate, you can fix with elements and just pinned, but they are not boundary conditions. They are fixed conditions. It's different. In miners, it's possible to consider initial exploration using without. Yes, you can use it. Yes, you can. You can take it. You can use and you can define also the consolidation calculations and whatever. Yes. How you will see the granular gap in the rock strata? I told you with the pea gravel, and you can simulate with the process I already mentioned. So I don't know if you have more questions. No? Pile addition to tunnel. Yes, you can simulate. You can simulate like this model. I don't know why I can't. Here, I don't know if I have here the. No, I don't have here the model. You can simulate with the piling, with the pile element. For example, if I don't know why here it's like that. Okay. Sorry. I don't know why you can't see my screen. Okay, here I don't have the I don't have here the model. I don't I don't have the model here, but yes, you can do it with pile elements without any problem. About cat zero, how would that means? Cat zero, for example, you can yes, it's impossible to port file from AutoCAD to one simulation media. Yes. About CAD zero, I will show you something. When you go to, I don't know what happens here. For example, let's open let's open one of these, a 3D model. Wait. Okay. When you come here in analysis, stage set here, you can define here. Okay. It's, I don't know why it's so low. Okay. In stage set here, you can define a stress. And then you can design also seepage consolidations. And then when you come here on the first element, wait, is I don't know why it is not happening. I mean, when you come here, I don't know why it is not happening. This. However, here you have a Let's open another one. Let's open, for example, this is easier. This is a 2D. Okay. Okay, here you have a, I don't know, Yakis, but why I can't select.
So, Koshimo, could you write about it?
You can open and you can select initial K0 stress or estimated stress from activated elements. So this is the, I wanted to show you, but I couldn't, I'm sorry. Okay. I don't know if you have more questions about it. No? It is possible minimum above and so above the panel. This is this depends. In Silvertown we work with 2 meters. So aqueduct in tunnel alignment. I don't understand this question. Any and stage by stage you should define. Yes, you can define stage by stage if you have the CAD zero. Yes, you can decide, you can define it stage by stage, or you can implement automatically CAD zero, which is what I recommend you. Is possible to have the PDF? I think so. No. Okay.
So okay, Koshimo.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you for your presentation today.
You're welcome.
Yeah. So any other questions that are not response that we will follow up after this webinar? So. Okay, so thank you for attending today's webinar. So if you have any more questions, then so okay, please contact our website. And then please email us with the geotech@midasit.com. This is end of today's webinar. And thank you for your attention. And I hope you see later next webinar. And keep safe in this COVID pandemic. So thank you very much, everyone. And thank you, Cosimo, for your presentation.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.